You're listening to the audio production of Grace for the Moment, Volume 2, More Inspirational Thoughts for Each Day of the Year, by Max Lucado, published by Thomas Nelson and read by Ben Holland.
Preface. My daughters have long stopped doing this, but there was a time when they celebrated my daily arrival. Jenna was 5 years old, Andrea 3. Dinalyn would alert them, and they would scamper to the window, pressing noses and hands against the tall pane that paralleled the front door. As I pulled into the drive, I would see them. Andrea and Jenna, a head taller than her sister, squeezed into the frame. Seeing me, they squealed. My, how they jumped and clapped. You'd think someone had switched their M&Ms for coffee beans. No returning Caesar ever felt more welcomed. As I opened the door, they tackled my knees and flooded the entryway with tsunami-sized joy. Their father was home. It's been too long since I searched for God that way. Too seldom do I hear thunder and think, "Is that God?" I've been known to let a day, even two, pass without a glance to the eastern sky. Let's do better. Let heaven fill your thoughts. Do not think only about things down here on earth. Colossians 3:2. How about regular ladle dips into the well of God's grace? Drink deeply, my friend, and drink daily. Max Lucado. God's Gifts. Have you ever wondered why God gives so much? We could exist on far less. He could have left the world flat and gray. We wouldn't have known the difference. But he didn't. He splashed orange in the sunrise and cast the sky in blue. And if you love to see geese as they gather, chances are you'll see that too. Did he have to make the squirrel's tail furry? Was he obliged to make the birds sing? And the funny way that chickens scurry, or the majesty of thunder when it rings? Why give a flower fragrance? Why give food its taste? Could it be, he loves to see, that look upon your face? If we give gifts to show our love, how much more would he? If we, speckled with foibles and greed, love to give gifts, how much more does God, pure and perfect God, enjoy giving gifts to us? From He Chose the Nails. January. I have chosen the way of truth. Psalm 119:30. January 1. Packed for a purpose. He has filled them with skill. Exodus 35:35. You were born pre-packed. God looked at your entire life, determined your assignment, and gave you the tools to do the job. Before traveling, you do something similar. You consider the demands of the journey and pack accordingly. Cold weather? Bring a jacket. Business meeting? Carry the laptop. Time with grandchildren? Better take some sneakers and pain medication. God did the same with you. Joe will research animals. Install curiosity. Megan will lead a private school, an extra dose of management. I need Eric to comfort the sick. Include a healthy share of compassion. Dinalyn will marry Max. Instill a double portion of patience. God packed you on purpose for a purpose. From Cure for the Common Life. January 2. The Lord is with me. You are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Psalm 23:4. You are with me. Yes, you, Lord, are in heaven. Yes, you rule the universe. Yes, you sit upon the stars and make your home in the deep. But yes, 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 you are with me. The Lord is with me. The Creator is with me. Yahweh is with me. Moses proclaimed it. What great nation has a God as near to them as the Lord our God is near to us? Deuteronomy 4:7. Paul announced it. He is not far from each one of us. Acts 17:27. And David discovered it. You are with me. Somewhere in the pasture, wilderness, or palace, David discovered that God meant business when he said, I will not leave you. Genesis 28:15. From Traveling Light. January 3. Loaded with love. He loads me with love and mercy. Psalm 103:4. It's time to let God's love cover all things in your life, all secrets, all hurts, all hours of evil, minutes of worry. The mornings you awoke in the bed of a stranger, His love will cover that. The years you peddled prejudice and pride, His love will cover that. Every promise broken, drug taken, penny stolen, every cross word, cuss word, and harsh word, His love covers all things. Let it. Discover along with the psalmist, He loads me with love and mercy. Picture a giant dump truck full of love. There you are behind it. God lifts the bed until the love starts to slide. Slowly at first, then down, 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 until you are hidden, buried, covered in His love. Hey, where are you? Someone asks. In here, covered in love. From A Love Worth Giving. January 4. The Author of Life. He who was dead sat up and began to speak, and Jesus presented him to his mother. Luke 7:15. The mourners didn't cause him to stop, nor did the large crowd, or even the body of the dead man on the stretcher. It was the woman, the look on her face, and the redness in her eyes. He knew immediately what was happening. It was her son who was being carried out, her only son. And if anyone knows the pain that comes from losing your only son, God does. So he did it. He went into action. Don't cry, he told the mother. Arise, he told the boy. The dead man spoke, the devil ran, and the people were reminded of this truth. For those who know the author of life, death is nothing more than Satan's dead man's bluff. From God Came Near. January 5. God Honors Work. Whatever work you do, do your best. Ecclesiastes 9:10. Heaven's calendar has 7 Sundays a week. God sanctifies each day. He conducts holy business at all hours and in all places. He uncommons the common by turning kitchen sinks into shrines, cafes into convents, and 9-to-5 workdays into spiritual adventures. Workdays? Yes, workdays. He ordained your work as something good. Before He gave Adam a wife or a child, even before He gave Adam breeches, God gave Adam a job. Then the Lord God took the man and put him into the Garden of Eden to cultivate it and keep it. Genesis 2:15. Innocence, not indolence, characterized the first family. God unilaterally calls all the physically able to till the gardens He gives. God honors work. So honor God in your work. From Cure for the Common Life. January 6. Miraculous Moments. In Christ, there is all of God in a human body. Colossians 2:9. Jesus was not a God-like man, nor a man-like God. He was God-man, midwifed by a carpenter, bathed by a peasant girl, the maker of the world with a belly button, the author of the Torah, being taught the Torah. Heaven's human. And because He was, we are left with scratch-your-head, double-blink, what's wrong with this picture? Moments like these. a cripple sponsoring the town dance, a sack lunch satisfying 5,000 tummies. What do we do with such moments? What do we do with such a person? We applaud men for doing good things. We enshrine God for doing great things. But when a man does God things, one thing is certain. We can't ignore him. From Next Door Savior. January 7. We need a big God. I am Yahweh. Exodus 6:2. The Israelites considered the name Yahweh too holy to be spoken by human lips. Whenever they needed to say Yahweh, they substituted the word Adonai, which means Lord. If the name needed to be written, the scribes would take a bath before they wrote it and destroy the pen afterward. The name I Am sounds strikingly close to the Hebrew verb to be, Hava. It's quite possibly a combination of the present tense form, I am, and the causative tense, I cause to be. Yahweh then seems to mean, I am and I cause. God is the one who is and the one who causes. Why is that important? Because we need a big God. And if God is the one who is, then he is an unchanging God. From Traveling Light. January 8. A Yoke of Kindness. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. Matthew 11:29. Farmers in ancient Israel used to train an inexperienced ox by yoking it to an experienced one with a wooden harness. The straps around the older animal were tightly drawn. He carried the load, but the yoke around the younger animal was loose. He walked alongside the more mature ox, but his burden was light. In this verse, Jesus is saying, I walk alongside you. We are yoked together, but I pull the weight and carry the burden. I wonder, how many burdens is Jesus carrying for us that we know nothing about? We're aware of some. He carries our sin. He carries our shame. He carries our eternal debt. But are there others? Has he lifted fears before we felt them? Has he carried our confusion so we wouldn't have to? Those times when we have been surprised by our own sense of peace? Could it be that Jesus has lifted our anxiety onto his shoulders and placed a yoke of kindness on ours? From A Love Worth Giving. January 9. Our Compassionate Christ. Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. Luke 23:34. Have you ever wondered how Jesus kept from retaliating against the mob that killed him? Have you ever asked how he kept his control? Here's the answer. It's this statement. For they do not know what they are doing. Look carefully. It's as if Jesus considered his bloodthirsty, death-hungry crowd not as murderers, but as victims. It's as if he saw in their faces not hatred, but confusion. It's as if he regarded them not as a militant mob, but, as he put it, as sheep without a shepherd. They don't know what they are doing. And when you think about it, they didn't. They hadn't the faintest idea what they were doing. They were a stir-crazy mob, mad at something they couldn't see, so they took it out on, of all people, God. But they didn't know what they were doing. From No Wonder They Call Him the Savior. January 10, Headed Home. He chose us in him before the foundation of the world. Ephesians 1:4. Search the faces of the Cap Haitian orphanage for Karenette, the girl with the long nose and bushy hair, and a handful of photos.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.